farewell.
If you want to get connected, lock into
Blue Peter.
Blue Peter. Gonna get myself. Mondays, Wednesdays and Fridays.
Blue Peter. Live.
Live.
Blue Peter.
If you make sure you're connected. 3 times a week, 3 times the fun. Blue Peter, Mondays, Wednesdays and Fridays at 5:10 on Children's BBC One.
Get connected. We have X-Men, we have Itsy Bitsy Spider, we have The Mask, so many great programmes coming your way very soon on The Breakfast Show this morning, all morning on Sunday morning, right up to 11:45. And we also have some of your pop-up entries for our pop-up competition. But right now it's time for Jackanory and Mr. Potter's Pigeon.
Mr. Potter lived quietly by himself at 35 Station Road, near the railway line. At the back of his house, there was a garden where nettles, dock, cow parsley, and tall foxgloves grew thickly in the shade. Mr. Potter was not very interested in weeding. At the end of the garden was a shed, but there were no rakes, spades, wheelbarrows, or oil cans in it, because Mr. Potter kept something much more important there. His racing pigeon. One Friday evening, Mr. Potter walked slowly down the brick path to his shed. He often went there when the garden was falling still and told the pigeon about the things that were in his mind. Tonight, he was thinking of the big race to be held on Sunday. When pigeons race, they are put into their cages, carried far away, and then set free. The pigeon, which can find its way home most quickly, is the winner. Mr. Potter was longing for his pigeon to win, but she was young, and the others were fast. And every pigeon, he said, does not win the race. Mr. Potter was a man of few words. His friends sometimes asked him why he looked so sad, and he would say that it was only his moustache. He had an old photograph of his father who had a grey moustache and looked sad too. And he was smiling all the time, said Mr. Potter. That night, the chimney cast its shadow like a dark blue ruler down the slates of the roof. The moon was full and bright. Mr. Potter was sitting safe in his kitchen, but outside, something was moving from shadow to shadow in the dark garden. Over by the shed, the tall leaves of the iris bed rustled mysteriously. Then they were parted by two cold, clear eyes that glittered like glass lemons in the moonlight. It was Lupin, the cat from next door. Without a sound, he slid into the shed where Mr. Potter's pigeon was asleep. The tip of Lupin's long black tail twitched from side to side as he sat quite still beneath the sleeping pigeon's cage. Then he leaped. His claws caught the metal latch, the door sprang open, and Mr. Potter's pigeon awoke with a start. She glanced at the shape of Lupin, crouched below her, eyes blazing, and with sudden clattering wings, she flew over his head and out into the clear night sky, leaving Lupin amazed and striking at the empty air with flashing claws. Mr. Potter's pigeon rose high above the village, and the moon seemed bright and close. Below her, the railway lines shone like tight wires. They led her to a curving river that reflected the dark trees along its banks. She flew down its silver course through strange fields and silent woods. She saw a line like the blade of a knife lying on the horizon. There was a sharp taste in the air, and she heard a low whispering sound. It was the sea. A beam of light swept over the waves and vanished. Then it came again and was gone again, and again came and again was gone. A shaft of light shining out to sea. On a rock surrounded by foam and roaring waves stood a tall lighthouse. The tired pigeon dropped out of the sky like a soft stone onto a narrow ledge and fell asleep. All through the night, the lighthouse flashed its warning out across the empty sea, while far away and warm in bed, Mr. Potter slept untroubled. Mr. Potter's pigeon awoke before dawn. It was cold, and a bitter wind blew around the lighthouse. She looked out at sea. The waves were empty except for a small black fishing boat on its way home. She looked towards the land, and the hills rose comfortingly, with trees and church spires pointing to the village where she belonged. That was enough. As the sun rose, she left the lighthouse behind her and set off to find the way home to Mr. Potter. Mr. Potter was having his breakfast when he suddenly dropped his spoon. The shed! He had forgotten to shut the door the night before. He ran down the red brick path and found the pigeon's cage open, empty, except for one grey feather. Oh, no, groaned Mr. Potter. He could not believe it, and he stared at the cage, expecting the pigeon to appear at any moment. But she did not. Mr. Potter fetched his binoculars and looked worriedly at the sky. A voice in his head said, "She has gone for good." But he kept on looking. Hours passed, and the sun grew hot. So he took off his jacket and put on a sun hat made from a folded page of the newspaper. "Oh, dear," said Mr. Potter sadly to himself. "You can't win a pigeon race without a pigeon, you know." Lupin walked across the garden and rubbed himself against Mr. Potter's legs, purring loudly. Mr. Potter bent down and stroked him. "A cat will always be a cat," he observed with a long sigh. Just as he was thinking, Lupin looked especially well-fed. Mr. Potter heard a whirring of wings above him, and he looked up eagerly. There was his pigeon, sitting calmly on the roof of the shed as if she had never been away. Mr. Potter raised his hands. The pigeon flew down into them, and he pressed her soft grey back against his cheek. "You've come back for the race, then," he said with a chuckle. And the pigeon blinked her beady black eyes. That night, Mr. Potter slept well. He dreamed that his pigeon asked him to fly with her, and they soared over a rainbow in the sky. On the day of the race, Mr. Potter got up at 5 o'clock and put his pigeon into a wicker travelling basket. He looked up at the mantelpiece and imagined how a silver cup would look beside his father's photograph. "Very nice indeed," said Mr. Potter as he went down to the station. "It would be nice to win." It was 6 o'clock when he arrived on the platform. The train was due to leave at 6:10 to take the pigeons on their long journey to the starting place. But Mr. Potter waited with his pigeon on his knees until the guard came and put her carefully inside and blew his whistle. Mr. Potter felt that he was losing her again. "She'll be all right," the guard said, as the train left the station with a blast of steam. When everything was ready, the race began. Mr. Potter's pigeon flew out of her basket, but to her surprise, she found a thick fog was hiding the country below her. On every side, she saw the confused shapes of the other pigeons flying in all directions. Then, something white glistened nearby. She nearly fell out of the sky with surprise. There was the lighthouse where she'd slept, ghostly and familiar in the fog. Now she knew exactly which way to go, and she flew back up the river towards the railway and 35 Station Road, as if it was the clearest day she'd ever seen. Mr. Potter sat waiting in his kitchen with the rain falling down outside. Again and again he peered through the rain, but the sky was empty. So he hummed a tune to keep himself calm. "A watch pot never boils," said Mr. Potter. He filled the kettle for another cup of tea. Hours passed, and the rain went on falling, but the sky was empty. And the rain was still falling, and the sky was still empty, as Mr. Potter finished his fifth cup of tea. At last the rain stopped, and Mr. Potter ran outside. A flicker of grey, like a speck of ash, appeared in the clearing sky. A pigeon. Mr. Potter held his breath as it came closer. For a moment it seemed that it was going to fly on overhead, but then it came circling down towards the garden. Mr. Potter's pigeon flew gently into his waiting hands. "My beauty," he murmured. And then a strange thing happened. Mr. Potter heard the sound of beating wings above him. It grew louder and louder, and then all the pigeons that had been lost in the fog came tumbling out from behind the clouds. They had followed Mr. Potter's pigeon home. On and on they came, until the lawn was a rustling carpet of grey feathers, and the air was filled with soft voices. So Mr. Potter's pigeon came home first and won the race. Mr. Potter laughed behind his moustache and said, "Who would have thought it?" And who would?
Well, the BBC isn't 64, it's 60. Yes, BBC Television is 60 this weekend, and to help us celebrate, we have the star of many Jackanories coming in to see us later, Bernard Cribbins, our star guest this morning. Now, why am I just covered with all loads of goodies? It's not a car boot sale, folks. It's actually all the prizes for our pop-up card competition, and as you can see, loads to match the category that you might fall in your age group. Loads and loads of prizes. Also a few pop-up books that we haven't got on show, which we'll give you loads and loads. I haven't got room. Okay, by the way, I hope you get well, Josie. She's not very well this morning. Well, we assume that she's not. So there isn't any Master Trough this morning, but never mind. Let me show you some of these pop-up cards that we have here. Okay, we're going to send a goodie bag to everyone we show. The first one here, it says a pop-up children's BBC set. And if we open it up, wow, from Anna McKenzie, who's 10 from Upton Wirral. She's made a pop-up children's BBC. We've even got the demon headmaster here popping up from behind the television. Don't look in his eyes. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Anna.
We've got another one here. It's a bit of a joke, this one. You ready? There's a cow on the front. It says, "Why do I watch children's BBC?" And he pops up inside and says, "Because I'm mad." Because I'm mad about it. And there's a cow. Can you see that? It's a bit white. Yes, I know. He sounds like a duck. That's from Sarah Bennison, who's 12 and comes from 5. There is a joke there, isn't there? I can't remember it. Now, here's another card. It says on the front, "Hope you feel..." This is just for you, Josie. "Hope you feel on top of the world." Oh, what a great card. And that's from Katie Sprague, who's 9 from Abingdon. Thank you very much indeed. Another one, goodie bag coming to you. Now, here's somebody who used to work on Children's BBC, Flipper Forrester. Do you remember her? Oh, great star. Now on Tomorrow's World. And we've got Flipper on the front here, the other Flipper that goes, And inside, wow, a big, big flipper. Oh, the other way up. And this is from Emma Mills, who's 7 from Abbey Wood. Very good, and we love flipper. We love flipper. Two monster cars from a brother and sister. First of all, here is the sisters, and Iona Holland, this is your one, and on the front it says, open wide, monster inside. If open up, what a monster. Thank you very much, Iona. And your brother has sent one in as well, and he's called James, and he's done a funny monster to go with that scary one. Here we go. Whoa! Thank you very much, James. There is your funny monster. Thank you very much for that one. And we've got another one here. I just want to say, Jack in the Box, and this is from Laura Dowling, who's 10 from Edenbridge. I just want to say, well, hey, Jack in the Box. Happy birthday, if it's your birthday today. Oh, another birthday card. Now, we do have different age groups to go with our different prizes that we've got to give away for the different categories of winners. We have under 8s, 8 to 12, and over 12. Loads of cards and presents to give away. Plus, we have our pop-up books as well, which aren't on show today because we didn't have room. If you want to enter, it's the usual Children's BBC address. Eek the Cat's coming up very, very soon. But right now, it's time to join the X-Men. Xavier, you've